So it's a boring Sunday night, as Sunday nights often are for me. So I decided I wanted to fill the time by doing something I've actually been meaning to do for a little while, and that's talk about the casting decisions regarding the main six kids in my adaptation of Runaways. Along with some more general feelings, I hope to have an actual commentary reel to go along with the one-hour edition. That is still going to happen. The full experience thing, you know, stringing them together as a compilation movie. That's still going to happen, but I actually noticed a lot more audio errors and just like things that I thought to myself, I could fix that. When I was re-listening to episodes 1 through 6, and you know, I was catching stuff that I wasn't necessarily looking for or being overly concerned about at the time. So the whole shebang version is going to come, but I just need, I found I need more time to work on it than I initially thought, to get a lot of the fuzz out, to clean up a lot of what some characters are saying, to mess with the foreground and background and all that. So, you know, that'll come when it's done. Along with that, I want to clarify that although I've had some hesitations, it is at least at this point my intent to do books 7 through 18, but I'm saying that before I've had a good solid chance to communicate with most of the cast, but they all seemed like they'd be supportive of it. It's just a matter of Nico's voice actress actually lives on the other side of the country right now, and so it's just kind of a question of do we go a long distance Skype like solution, or do I find another actress? And you know, there are complications both ways. So more on that later. Though I wanted to make this video primarily to talk about the casting of Runaways and how I wanted to bring life to these characters who have made careers out of getting shafted by Marvel. It's interesting for me to note, by the way, just talking about the development of this series, that I couldn't find like any video on YouTube of anyone like doing, not even like just fan dubs, but like no one was like just reading lines out of boredom. There's videos of cosplayers. That's kind of cool, but like, and they're not reciting the lines from the books or anything, and I just, that was really kind of a moment of, wow, well, I would like to give some life to these characters. So, you know, that's part of it. It was a lot of things that made the production come to be, and, you know, undoubtedly in my mind, the biggest contributing factor to an audiobook is obviously going to be who do you cast in it, and how do you talk about that, and what do they bring to the table, and what's unique about each actor, and all that. And so, Runaways had the really cool addition that the six kids are all played by close personal friends. For better or for worse, I'm not totally sure I'm going to go back to a more traditional audition process in the future. Websites are just, I have not had as much luck on websites trying to cast voice actors from over the internet. And, like, that's not their fault. I would assume if it's anything, it's just that my projects don't necessarily appeal to a lot of, to you know, the kind of mainstream audience a lot of amateur voice actors are going for. And a matter that, I have a history of like, let me attach myself to this project and this project and this project and so forth. I'm known to like try and pick up lots of things, and a good chunk of them crash and burn. Now that Halfway Beret is moving the way it is, I'm trying to ensure that happens less, and hence why I'm trying to make sure Runaways issues 7 through 18 still happen, along with other series that I've got in the works right now. I do have some other things I intend to do for the channel here soon. More adaptions, namely, but more on that when it comes. So, in this case, just six personal friends handpicked by me. And talking about the process of that, most of the actors were actually Funnily enough, we're kind of cast based on appearance, which sounds really weird for an audio project, but, you know, you kind of do assume. I think it is fair to assume that a character who, you know, an actor who looks like someone would more than likely maybe sort of sound like them. I think that's a fair assertion. I had initially announced the project on June 28th, 2014 on Facebook, although I've been talking to my girlfriend for a little while before that because, you know, she had participated in Scott Pilgrim and everything. And with the initial announcement, I had tagged four people. Trey McIntosh was tagged as Alex Wilder, which he played. Maria Roxano was tagged as Gertrude Stein, whom she played. Gertrude Yorks. Thane Henderson was tagged as Chase Stein, whom he played. And Samantha Robinson was tagged as Carolina Dean. Samantha Robinson did not play a part in this series. Ultimately, we had talked about it, but ultimately it didn't happen because just a busy, hectic schedule on her end, so I had to cast another Carolina at that point. Shortly thereafter, I was looking over the cast, and I wasn't totally aware of, I'd kind of let it slip my mind how many people I had to cast. So there came a question of, well, who do I cast for Molly? And this had come a few weeks after I had been babysitting one of my younger cousins, a couple of my younger cousins, Morgan Sickerson, and two of her siblings. And so I just kind of, I had had a chance to see Morgan really excitable and I saw she had really good energy and everything. So I was like, yeah, that could work. Because I wanted a real child actress for the role. I didn't want to do an impression. I wanted someone genuinely, you know, pretty young. I mean, Morgan was like 12 or 13 when she played the part, but, you know, she still sounds pretty convincing in the role, so that's really cool. And then finally, there came a question of Nico, which I wasn't really sure about for quite a while. And actually, at first glance, I was under the impression that Nico was Russian. So, and that's also a matter of, you know, associating that Russian-Serbian area with the name Nico. Damn you, Grand Theft Auto 4, what have you done to me? We've not heard anything. I've never seen anything from the creators, but I kind of assumed Nico was short for Nicolette, which, you know, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. Not really relevant. And there was a question about that role for a little bit before it ultimately went to Jamie Whitney, who was a college friend of mine, and Meredith Phipps got cast in the role of Carolina. So there's kind of there's a brief rundown of the big six. I'm going to talk about what each individual actor brings to the table and what I really, really liked about their performances. So at first glance, casting Trey as Alex kind of seemed, I guess it was, I mean, you know, maybe you could argue it was motivated by that whole, you know, he's my black friend. I called him that in the blooper reel. Trey is my black friend. I have multiple, but Trey is my best black friend. But and something that I'm going to repeat a bunch of times is that all of these guys are trained stage actors, or almost all of them are. There's two notable exceptions, but four of these guys are trained theater actors. So, you know, it wasn't like I just cast him and he'd never read off a script before. No. They all knew what they were doing, and they were very professional about it. So that was really cool. Trey brought a nice presence to Alex because he gives a very base but very human feeling to the character in my mind. And by that I mean, like, you know, you can't peg Alex as anything just by hearing Trey's voice. You can't peg him as a gamer. You can't peg him as, you know, there's you know, there's unfortunately those stereotypes where, you know, you hear a black kid's voice and then go, oh, he's got to be a thug of some kind. No, you can't pin him as a thug. And once you really hear Trey get talking is when you can really pin Alex as an intellectual, which he is. And Trey brings that nice gravitas to the role. He gives a genuine performance, and you know, when he needs to react to something big, because Alex does have some big reactions. Everybody's got some big reactions here and there, but you know, yeah, Alex's dad just killed some chick. What? Just like, you know, stuff like that. Trey brought a very nice presence to. And he, you know, he, again, a very genuine, very human performance to the character. And also, Trey doesn't much, when I hear him talk, strike me as someone who plays the long game, which I won't spoil the rest of the episodes of Runaways, but I'll say that Alex is a good faker. He is a very good faker. And Trey fakes at being a good faker very well. I did tell everyone all about their characters right from the beginning, including, you know, little bits that aren't necessarily going to be included in these books themselves. But I'll talk about that as I go on. But yeah, I wanted Trey in because Trey is smart. He knows how to give a good humanizing performance, and he's very focused. When Trey gets acting, he gets very focused, and he gives a rather intense performance, actually. So once you get him, you know, once he gets in the mood and he's focused, you know, and in particular when he says, you know, I'd rather blow my brains out than go back to your lies, that's a very intense moment, and I really liked what Trey brought to it, so that was very nice. And that's really, really a lot of the reason why he got the role. Talking about Gert next. Incidentally, whether you guys know it or not, there actually is a consistent pattern to a lot of things I do, in that I almost universally, when going over things of mine, I go Alex, Gert, Carolina, Chase, Molly, Nico. And I do that because that's the order the characters were introduced in the book. And you can't really, it's nearly impossible to tell on a lot of things, but like, if I'm tagging people on Facebook, I actually tag all their actors in the order in which they appeared. So, there's a bit of trivia for you. And I mentally think of them that way, too. I think of them in that order. So, moving on, talking about Gert next. Gert, of course, played by Maria Roxana, who Maria was the one of two actors on this I had worked with before. And Maria had played a part in a student-directed one-act play I wrote and directed back in high school, which I really, really, really wish I could show you guys footage of, because it was great. It was great. And, you know, again, just kind of comparing the two characters, you can see some of their, you know, base physical similarities, but, like, Maria was, one of the cool things I liked about working and talking to Maria was that she, you know, she acted and she, you know, you would look at her and you would kind of stereotypically think, oh, punk. We got a punk girl over here, you know. She's got the various piercings. She wore a lot of black, you know, various things with her hair in high school and stuff. I've seen her in various stages of colored hair. But it's like, you know, once you get to talking to her, you know, she defies a lot of the stereotypes while reinforcing a few others. In that, you know, she's really, really smart and well-spoken and just, and you know, she's not half as antisocial as Gert is. That's the thing. She's much nicer than Gert, but she kind of puts on an air of inherent, you know, don't get too close in some sense. But you know what? That works for some people. So why the hell not? And you know, incidentally, like, I didn't really like Gert as a character when we sat down to do things. I didn't, you know, she just didn't really appeal to me. She was a little too annoying, but like, you know, Once I heard Maria reading the lines, it was very much a matter of, wow, I see her point. Or, you know, maybe she comes off as a little cold and distant sometimes, but, like, I got more of that humility. And that's something that I can basically say about all of the actors, is that I felt a greater sense of humility in the characters when it was all over. And they're very human characters to begin with, so. The Maria gives, you know, this strong, again, focused performance. She had a little less, she was on stage a little less than the rest of us, but she likes what she does, and she likes working on stuff like this, and she's really cool to work with, and I very much enjoyed it, and I would be happy to have her back in another role for a future project, and that pretty much goes for the entire cast, so. Those are kind of my thoughts on casting Gert as Maria, or Maria as Gert, rather. Although I will acknowledge that it's kind of funny. Maria is Latino, actually, and Gert is, racially Jewish. So, you know, it's... Before I talk about how interesting the casting of Nico was, I'll throw that one out there. I had a Latino girl playing a Jewish girl, so that's kind of silly. But again, you know, it's about the kind of performance you can put on. So that was really great. As mentioned, I move from Gert on to Carolina. Carolina's position, as mentioned, kind of juggled around. The initial person I wanted to do Carolina's voice was, her name's Samantha Robinson. She is a friend from high school. And interestingly enough, she used to date Thane, who is Chase's voice actor, and Chase hits on Carolina a lot, so that was kind of funny. I mean, you know, obviously not trying to play matchmaker, Thane has a girlfriend, but it just would have been funny in some sense. And again, Samantha has some physical resemblance to Carolina, actually, so it was more of playing, you know, who resembles the character and who has acting experience, both of which Samantha has, but ultimately it didn't work out. So it was a matter of, well, who do I go to next? And Meredith, my girlfriend, was actually talking to me. We were talking about Runaways and production a little after I'd announced things. And she was bitter as a Runaways fan that I hadn't initially, you know, in the initial step forward and being like, hey, who wants to play some roles? I hadn't tagged her. And my response was just like, hon, we're too old to play these characters. You know, casting entirely people just like 1 or 2 years younger than me. We're too old to play these roles. That's silly. I acknowledge that now. That's very silly. And especially talking about Nico, that's going to get even more ridiculous. But that was my initial thought. And then actually, as she and I were talking about it, and again, I was under the impression Nico was Russian, so I would not have minded. I initially had no problem with a white person portraying Nico. Not that it stopped me anyway, but still. So originally, Meredith was kind of in line to play Nico, and we were kind of talking about that, and I'm sure she would have done a good job. I'm not saying otherwise at all. But eventually, as we were talking about stuff, and I realized Samantha Robinson wouldn't be playing the part of Carolina, I said, "Well, here are these two characters," and you know, I said she's a Runaways fan. She is, but it had been a while. So I was like, you know, here, re-examine these two characters. Here's the information that we're going to go off of. Please tell me which one you relate to more. And ultimately, she decided that she felt better playing the role of Carolina. It seemed to fall into place better. So I cast her as Carolina. It's not mentioned directly in any of the early stories, but I am strongly of the opinion that Vaughn and... The guys who wrote Runaways, Vaughn, V and A, Alfoza, Adrian Alfoza. I am strongly of the opinion that it was always their intention that Carolina Reed is a lesbian. I think there's enough evidence there in the early books that, yes, it's perfectly reasonable to draw that at the end of it. I know I said it isn't subtle at all, but no, I didn't notice it when I was first reading, actually. So kudos to them on that. So I told Meredith to portray it like that because I feel like that is part of the character, particularly in how she deals with her parents and everything. And Meredith ultimately ended up being maybe one of the most fantastic choices I could have had for Carolina, because so many things about Carolina are, you know, subverted Valley girl. She's, you know, she's this beautiful blonde girl. You know, her parents are filthy rich. And she's got social anxiety, and she suffers from bipolar disorder. She's a lesbian. The list goes on. She's subverted Valley girl, and she wants so bad to just be normal. So she, you know, she suppresses all this, and she's smiling, and you see her mom with that big damn Botox smile that creeps me the hell out. And, you know, Meredith lends one more piece to that, because Meredith is not a Valley girl. She happily doesn't consider herself one, but she was happy to act like one for a little while, and then we see it kind of slowly break down. And her voice is, she's got a very unique voice, and I mean that in a very highly complimentative way, which just kind of says to me that, like, you add that voice to Carolina, and it's like, she's already got all these stereotypes associated with her and everything, but you can already tell that something's off-center. She doesn't sound like a stereotypical Valley girl. Meredith never put on the voice like a totally stereotypical Valley girl, so she's just, like, getting to incorporate vocals into this. I feel like it allowed me to add another layer to the story, which was really damn cool, so that's a lot of what I have to say about the casting of Meredith as in the role of Carolina, which was ultimately a great, great decision that I'm so glad she talked me into. So, good times, good times.
So, the thing about doing Chase in a project like this is a question of, well, what side of the character do you end up working with? Because, you know, he portrays a couple of different stereotypes at once, unlike the rest of the cast, who are more, you know, you think you know what direction they're going in initially, and then they kind of subvert it. Chase is both kind of the closest thing the group has to a jock, and he's also, you know, he's the street smart guy. He says that himself, that he considers himself very street smart, and it's true. As we see, he's quite overly prepared for things as they come. So, you know, again, with the whole ink suit acting thing, with casting someone who visually resembles Chase, my friend Thane, who I've always wanted to have in a voice acting project because I've always really enjoyed the sound of his voice, and he's genuinely really kind of funny as hell. He was a very quick choice for me regarding that. And it also got to be really funny because Thane thought it would be a good, funny time kind of portraying an idiot. Which, like, you know, Chase is not a malevolent idiot, but yeah, he's kind of an idiot. If you note, in my bloopers video, in my video on the bloopers, I refer to Thane as my friend of ambiguous but most certainly not heterosexuality, which is what I consider him. So, you know, Thane Chase having that line, "Our parents must be totally gay," that was especially funny for Thane to say because, you know, and you know, he, again, like, he just liked playing kind of this street smart punk, but also he's got a good heart, is I guess what I can say about Chase. Is more than a lot of the rest of the cast in this video, he's got a really good heart, and he's got a good idea of what he's doing most of the time. But the trouble is, of course, that Chase has been dealing with years of personal, physical, parental abuse, so, you know, obviously it's left his mark. It's why he's very, very slow to get on the whole "our parents are killers" thing, and why we pointed out the irony that, you know, he would defend them when the very opening shot we saw him getting punched in the face. And Thane brought a lot of that. Like, the thing is, like, Chase doesn't get that big, huge moment like Carolina does, where she freaks out and just, you know, screams and punches her mom right in the face. Chase doesn't really get a moment like that. But to kind of compensate for it, he has those moments where he's just muttering. And, you know, Alex says, you know, your dad tried to kill you. He's like, yeah, what else is new? And Thane brought some of that quiet nuance to the character that, you know, isn't obvious on the surface. Again, from the whole, you know, kind of dumb jock stereotype, Thane made a character who is in a lot of quiet mental pain. And, you know, that's something that's very impressive to do, and I was very pleased with the end result. The question of making Chase kind of jockey was always there, kind of like, should he be more burly, should he be more, you know, traditionally bro-y, like, yeah, and, you know. But the thing is, like, Chase is a lacrosse player, and I don't know anything about sports, but if lacrosse was an ultra-manly sport, I feel like I would know that. And, you know, he doesn't have the body type to be kind of that aggressive type, so ultimately, we decided, no, it's better to portray him, you know, more as the street punk. Yes, he's a jock, but we spend more time portraying him as the punk, which I think ultimately works out much better for the character, and was much easier for Thane to play. Just kind of this, you know, this guy who, like, you know, his parents have never appreciated anything he's done in his life. They're mad scientists, he's an athlete. He's run away from home before. He's, you know, he's a very interesting character, and he's way more interesting than, like, his initial appearance would let off, where you just figure, you can draw conclusions about him, sure, but, like, the fact that what a home life he comes from, and how that affects him, and how, you know, he suffers from a place where he's not appreciated, where no matter what he accomplishes, his father was never impressed with him, and he's just trying to do the right thing in this situation that's extremely difficult for him to understand and is very hard for any of them to go through. So, again, you know, Chase is a punk, yeah, but we didn't just play him as a punk, and I was very pleased with how they managed to pull that off.
As I kind of touched on already, Morgan Sickerson is the voice actress of Molly. And again, it was just because I wanted a real child actor of some kind or another. And, you know, I wanted to get someone fairly close to the age. And if you look at them, there is a physical resemblance even. But more than anything else, it was that, you know, Morgan has a great energy I've seen out of her before, and she really knows how to, if she's properly directed, she can put that in an incredible direction, and she does a really, really great job. And, you know, obviously there, you take what you can get when it comes to child actors, and you take what you can get with a kid who can only, you know, they can only hear you repeat the same thing so many times before, you know, that just like, no, I can't do a good impression of that. And I'm guilty of way too much line reading amongst my actors. And in future projects, I'm going to try and cut that down significantly. Just, you know, let them feel it more. But like, when Morgan felt it, she delivered a lot as Molly. Particularly in the later bits when, like, you know, when she wakes up with her powers and she's, you know, yes, I did a lot of stuff to her voice and made a lot of, you know, messed with the pitch and everything, but she still had to deliver that performance. She still had to deliver that aggression and that, you know, ooh, you know, that wonder sometimes it was, you know, when she says the cave is awesome and she, or, you know, when she's laughing or giggling about things. So, you know, that's one of the things that kind of is inherently follows a child character, and it's why Morgan turned out to be a really fun choice with it. And I'm very happy to have had, you know, my little cousin on board with something like this. And if the occasion rises, I will be very happy to have her on board again. Last but most certainly not least was Jamie Whitney as Nico Minoru. Now, as I'm sure I've made clear, and as I'm sure I made clear back in like Scott Pilgrim and stuff, I am a strong believer in a degree of racial sensitivity on these things. I don't want to take roles away from people. I want, you know, roles to go to, if a character has a race associated with them, then yes, I would prefer that character be played by someone of that race. And initially, at one point, my plan for Nico was that she would be voiced by Michelle Tran, who provided the voice of Knives Chow back in Scott Pilgrim. And because, you know, as I've said before, I like retaining voice actors across projects. I like moving someone from one project to another and all that. So it was very appealing to me. But I just kept putting it off because I was like, I haven't talked to Michelle since Scott Pilgrim. And it seemed kind of dickish to just be like, hey, you want to do another voice? Which I regret now, because she would have happily done the role. So I missed out on that. Nico would remain without a voice for a good chunk of time. She was the last of the six to be given an actor. But I had this friend in college. I have this friend. We're not in communication as much as we should be. I need to send some replies. But I had this friend from college. Her name is Jamie Whitney. And I talked to her and I was like, have you ever done anything theatrical? And the answer was no, but she'd always kind of wanted to. It seemed like it would be fun. So we just kind of toyed around with some ideas of some various roles she could pick up. And eventually I had her, you know, try and read some stuff for Nico. And actually, I really, really liked it and came out of it like, all right, maybe I've found my Nico now. But, you know, that comes with, again, a sense of, well, you know, do I want to stop trying to seek an Asian actress? And part of the matter is that at the end of the day, this is just voice work. You know, you can say a character has a voice, and the voice actor and their character of race, they don't have to match up. It's not necessary. And I prefer it. I'm not saying I don't prefer it, but sometimes you take ability over performance, particularly when you're talking about just listening to someone do a voice. And I didn't know any other, you know, Asian actresses who I felt could fill the role. So Jamie, having never really done anything heavy acting related before, you know, she is still an English student. She knows how to give a good presentation and talk about stuff. So knowing that, I used that to my advantage and just utilized that. She did some really solid reading. We had fun doing it. And particularly for someone who has never had any, you know, stage experience or anything, those emotional moments I really, really liked. Like when Nico has the confrontation with her mother and you know, she's like, you know, snap out of it. She's freaking out. And I was really impressed with how Jamie managed to handle that. She was really, really good at what she was doing. And that really goes for everybody. So at the end of the day, you know, these were six big shoes to fill that, frankly, have never been filled before. You know, the Runaways movie got put on hold indefinitely. Maybe we'll see it someday, and maybe we won't. Come the hell on, Marvel. Ugh. You're on top of the world. Make a TV series. No one's gonna stop you from making anything. But basically, giving these characters voices for the first time, and I mean, I've had other projects that I've looked into and other projects that I intend to direct in the future, which, yes, I have a more limited fan base, haven't had TV shows or movies or anything, but those characters have still been voiced by someone, and they've still been picked up by someone, and someone's made those performances their own, but in this case, there was nothing to go off of. So, really, it was just a matter of, you know, how do we transform these six actors into these six characters? And basically everyone just retained their natural voice. Everyone just gave it its emotional due. And that's how we got our Runaways. And I'm really, really proud of that. So that's my feelings on the main cast. And it was a really great cast to work with. I hope to get everybody back as we cover the next two books. I already know I'm getting some of them back, but, you know, some are in question, but I really hope I get them back, because for a project that, you know, went through a lot of craziness over the course of production, I'll get into that in the commentary reels, for a project that just was as huge, that felt as huge to me and as close to me as this ended up being, like, you know, I'm just never going to unhear those voices. These guys became my Runaways, and, you know, how cool is that?